very warm welcome to our service of worship this Lord's Day. And welcome to any visitors here today. Good to have you with us. And after the service, we look forward to going through to the large hall for tea, coffee, and a chat. One or two intimations I'll maybe give at the beginning of the service. I think most of them are there in print. Just to draw your attention, we now have receptacles for donations to assist the Ukrainian folks who will be coming to Aberdeen. So there's a lot happening, and we've been asked to donate these particular items that you have there in the intimations. And just to say that next Sunday I will be away, and morning worship will be led by Isabel Jackson. And although we're saying farewell to Jamie as an organist and choir leader, there's still the opportunity to hear Jamie leading worship at Jubilee next Sunday, the 1st of May. And that will be focusing on one of the resurrection appearances of Jesus. That's at Jubilee next Sunday evening. I will be on annual leave from tomorrow until returning next Monday, so be back from next week on Tuesday. And partial cover, I'll put details on the website and so on, will be covered by the Reverend David Stewart of South Holburn Church and the Reverend Peter Johnston of Ferry Hill, as we are now part of a larger grouping. And it just so happened that the ministers in the West End grouping all seem to be away at the same time. But there will be pastoral cover from David Stewart and Peter Johnston. So I think these are all the intimations. Oh, Jubilee meets this evening, and there is an opportunity to celebrate communion as we focus on the story of on the road to Emmaus. And of course, the followers recognized Jesus when he broke the bread with them. So you're invited to join in the responses here in bold print. We are here today because the weeping Mary of Magdala once said,
"I have seen the Lord."
We are here because Jesus still comes into our locked spaces and says,
"Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit."
We are here today like doubting Thomas, who finally cried,
"My Lord and my God."
We are here like Peter, tempted to forget the call of Jesus,
"I am going fishing."
We are here this morning because of Jesus, who asks us face to face,
"Do you truly love me?"
We gather here to whisper timidly,
"Yes, Lord, you have me."
We are here as a congregation only because many faithful disciples have listened to Jesus' words,
"Do not be afraid, do not be afraid. Go tell Jesus has been raised."
Now, our opening song today is one that we sang at the 8 o'clock Easter Sunday morning service at the Queen's Cross Terrace Gardens. And it was very moving when we sang that.
Jesus is risen.
risen Lord, present here with us. Feed us by the Holy Spirit, that we may go from here to tend your sheep, and to do so in your name and for your sake. Lord Jesus Christ, when we forget that you are alive, when we act as though you cannot speak for yourself, forgive us, we pray. When we are slow to ask for your advice and to look for your guidance, when we too easily think we know best and forge ahead regardless, because we are sure we know your mind, again, please forgive us. Remind us, Lord, of firm and gentle ways of how close and active you always are. For you are the ever-living Lord of all creation. Lord Jesus, may the Holy Spirit be free among us to move among us here and now. And give us the courage to let that Spirit renew and inspire us as through your word, your people, and your world. You speak to us of hope and faith and love, and challenge us to live lives that are faithful to your cause of justice and peace. Hear us now, as together with all your people, we pray the words you taught your friends, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to continue in our worship with our next hymn, Lord, you have come to the seashore.
Lord, you have come to the seashore.
Thank you.
psalm will be given by our session clerk, Sheila Smith, and our gospel reading will be given by our co-session clerk, Martin Gray.
Psalm 30. A psalm, a song for the dedication of the temple of David. I will exalt you, O Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. O Lord my God, I called to you for help, and you healed me. O Lord, you brought me up from the grave. You spared me from going down into the pit. Sing to the Lord, you saints of his. Praise his holy name. For his anger lasts only a moment, but his favour lasts a lifetime. Weeping may remain for a night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. When I feel secure, I said, I shall never be shaken. O Lord, when you favoured me, you made my mountain stand firm. But when you hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I called, to the Lord I cried for mercy. What gain is there in my destruction if I go down into the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it proclaim your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be merciful to me. O Lord, be my help. You turned my wailing into dancing. You removed my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, that my heart may sing to you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give you thanks forever.
From John chapter 21, from verses 4 to 14. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, "Friends, haven't you any fish?" "No," they answered. He said, "Throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, "It is the Lord," he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there, with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you have just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread, and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Amen.
Thank you very much to our readers today, Sheila and Martin, and sorry to put Martin on the spot there. And with Martin reading, I just remind you one intimation that's not in print, but it's an important one for folks to be aware of, is on Wednesday the 11th of May, there's going to be a meeting here in the sanctuary for a group being set up to look at the future use of the building. Communications have gone out from the community council, and so a special meeting is taking place on Wednesday 11th of May at 7:30, and folks are very welcome to come along to that, because it would be one group that would then be going into discussion and negotiation with the Presbytery and Church of Scotland. So it's a group that involves the wider community and obviously interested church members as well. So it's an important meeting, and that group would elect representatives for that, and Martin will be there chairing that meeting. So I draw that to your attention. We're going to be looking at mountains, sun and sea in the reflection this morning. So here we sing a hymn that celebrates that mountain of the Lord. Behold, the mountain of the Lord, hymn 715. Loving God, in praise and thanksgiving, we present these offerings as we present ourselves afresh, to be listening, receptive to your word, and to be active and motivated in our response by the moving of your Spirit. Bless these offerings, that they may be instruments and agents of the kingdom of God in the world in which we live. Amen. And now may the words of my lips, the meditation of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our Rock and Redeemer. Amen. Easter is all about the living God. God is alive. Jesus is alive. And rather strangely, in today's Gospel reading, it's all about the one who got away even from death. How do we celebrate today Christ being alive? How do we make the space to listen for Christ's voice speaking to us today? How do we find the courage to do as Jesus asks, letting go of years of experience and habits in favour of casting our nets differently, as Jesus calls us to? We are really being asked what the implications are of worshipping a living, moving, active God who cannot be contained. The Easter stories remind or recall events in Jesus' earthly ministry. As we reflected last Sunday, there's a continuity, but there's also something different and strange and surprising for the people to catch on to. Jesus' life, ministry, teaching, remind and recall events in the Old Testament. The Gospel writers, when they reflected on Jesus' life and ministry, could see how Old Testament verses were fulfilled in Jesus' life, his death and resurrection. And Psalm 30, which we heard today, written many hundreds of years before Jesus lived on earth, has something of that spirit or sense of death and resurrection. He turned my wailing into dancing. It's a beautifully poetic psalm that through its words offers real life reassurance of the God who is with us in the depths as well as in the heights. In fact, this psalm goes further still and holds out the hope of a God who not only meets us in our suffering, but who takes the sackcloth from us and clothes us instead with joy. This is not to brush over the reality of the tough times and experiences that fall to the human lot. It is to talk of the God who accompanies us through them, sharing our tears before bringing us to healing and wholeness. Very much in keeping with the new life theme of Easter and with the notion of God's transforming, generous, and saving kindness. Today I'm going to use some motifs which can be aid memoirs for the people of God. And we all have different ways of sometimes approaching a sermon, and I must admit that just the past week or two I've been intrigued by the paintings of Vincent van Gogh. I'm told it's Gogh, not Gogh, not Go, but Gogh, apparently is the Dutch pronunciation. And it's partly through a conversation with Isabel who went to the Van Gogh or Gogh exhibition in Edinburgh and found it very moving and inspiring, Alan and Isabel. And therefore I looked at some of his paintings and thought that this might help us as a sense of aid memoir of the God who is alive and present among us. And so we're going to go to our first Van Gogh painting, and this is one of the mountain. And I'll give you a moment just to have a look at that painting. And you'll see it goes to different levels, the air of the land, and then away in the distance, up high, is the mountain, and just very much that Van Gogh style of painting. And Van Gogh himself said that the gospel is the top of the mountain of which the Old Testament and the letters of the apostles are the slopes. So in this picturesque way, can we imagine that before the Gospels, before the life, the ministry, the death and resurrection of Christ, there were things building up to the mountain, such as the slopes there. And of course, when we look at the image of the mountain, there are so many resonances within Scripture. Mount Sinai, where the Ten Commandments were given to Moses. Mount Tabor, where Jesus appeared in the mountain to Peter, James and John, the Mount of Transfiguration. Jesus giving his sermon on the Mount that we hear of in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5. The feeding of manna in Exodus. The feeding of the 5,000 that Jesus celebrated in the Gospels. If we think of other aspects of the Old Testament pointing towards the Gospel, pointing towards Jesus, the Psalms, when we read the Psalms in the light of Jesus, in the light of his ministry, they bring a new resonance to us. And particularly when we hear the words that were said by Jesus from the cross, those are echoes of the Psalms that were previously said. And of course, the great prophets that we hear of in the Old Testament, and we see these prophets reflected in the life, the teaching, the courage of Jesus confronting the rulers of his time. He's very much like the prophet Elijah, confronting evil and those in power, speaking truth to power. And then also that sense of the prophecies being fulfilled, the prophecies that there would be the suffering servant that we hear of in the book of Isaiah, and the one that was to bear a child would be called Emmanuel, God is with us. And so when I look at that painting, I get that sense of just all those things leading up to the mountain, leading up to the revelation of Jesus. It's also interesting in a resurrection appearance that we're going to be focusing on this evening, that when the two disciples were on the road to Emmaus with Jesus, the stranger who came alongside them opened up to them the scriptures to the two disciples and said how they pointed to that the Son of Man would need to suffer. And then, of course, when Jesus breaks bread with them, they realize that this stranger is Jesus himself. So our prayer might be, let me see your presence in the Psalms, in the prophets, and in the great story of the people of Israel, and let this insight help me better understand my own history, my own struggle, and my own pain. And if we go into the next painting, we see the painting by Van Gogh of the parable of the sower and the seed, and very striking is the sun. The sunshine, a source of light, source of energy. The sun is always shining. And like the earth, our vision of it is temporarily obscured as the earth revolves. And so we have day and night. And these themes of light and darkness are very much reflected in the fourth gospel, the gospel according to John. Darkness and light, death and resurrection, coldness and heat. Jesus says, I am the light of the world. For Van Gogh in his Lazarus painting, Christ is represented by the sun. And if we just move to that, well, there's a close-up of the sun in that painting, very striking, just those beautiful, rich, dynamic colours of the artist Van Gogh. And then if we move on to the next painting, this is one also by Van Gogh, and it is the raising of Lazarus. And what's striking here is you see the sister, Martha, or maybe Mary, coming up to the tomb. You don't actually see Jesus, and it's suggested that Jesus is represented by the sun in this painting. It's very much in contrast to a painting by Rembrandt, which is the next painting, which is much more enclosed in a sort of confined, built-up area where you see Lazarus at the centre just starting to rise from the tomb, and you see the figure of Jesus. So two very different types of paintings, both dealing with the theme of the raising of Lazarus. And for Van Gogh, I said in his painting, Christ is represented by the sun. And quite often in different poetry and lyrics, there is often a play on the words sun, S-O-N, and S-U-N, that the S-O-N of God is also the sun that brings light and healing and nurture and energy to the world, bringing life and resources. Let me just read a little bit about this painting and a reflection by Henry Nouwen. It's in the form of a prayer, but I hope you find this a helpful prayer on Van Gogh's son. So, if one could ask you to just move back to the sun. Dear Lord, free me from my dark past, into which I often feel myself falling as if into a deep system. You are the light that has come into the world so that whoever believes in you need not stay in darkness any longer. Do not allow me to sink back into my own dark pit, O Lord, but let your warm, gentle, life-giving light lift me from my grave. Vincent van Gogh painted you as the sun when he painted the resurrection of Lazarus. In so doing, he wanted to express his own liberation from a dark, imprisoning past. Lord, keep showing me your light and give me the strength to rise and follow you without ever looking back. You are my strength, my refuge, and my stronghold. As long as I keep my eyes on you, there is no reason to return to past events, past patterns, past ideas. In your light, all becomes new. Let me be fully yours. Amen. And then we're going to move on now to the image of the sea. And here is one painting giving that picture of the gospel story where the net is thrown over and the fish are gathered. And of course, as we look at that in John chapter 21, it reminds us of the first calling of the disciples that we read of earlier in the gospels. But here it is the risen Jesus who is calling the disciples. And he's giving the instruction once again to throw the net out on the other side. And there is this great catch of fish, 153, but giving a specific number. And it has been said that the 153 is the number of nations, recognized nations of the world in the first century, at the time the gospel was written. It is a story that stands alone with a message that says that the bottom line, Jesus knows best. Listen to him, follow his prompting, follow his leading, his guidance, and fruitful things will happen. There will be a harvest of fish. And of course, it's also a story which contains many echoes and threads of earlier events. The three questions to Simon Peter later in that gospel reading counteract the three denials of Peter. The charcoal barbecue fire negating the charcoal courtyard fire on the night of Jesus' arrest. Could we move on to the next painting? The disciples in a boat with their nets, taking us back to the day Jesus called them. The words, come follow me, resonating here in the words, come meet with me, Could his friends' lives be about to take yet another new direction with the presence of the risen Jesus by the shore of Lake Galilee? Jesus hands the bread to his friends, stirring memories within them of the night in which he was arrested, having handed round bread and then wine. And the number of fish, one for every known nation at the time, symbolizing the all-encompassing nature of the coming of God's Son for everyone, not just for a select few, but for every nation. And then you have that picture of the wonderful haul of fish, tying things back to the very first miracle Jesus performed when he changed gallons of water into gallons of wine. John's pen has Jesus' life bracketed by stories of God's extravagance, his generosity, stories of God's extravagant provision for God's people. An extravagance born of an entirely unselfish, loving concern for every person. And so there is a sense that the risen Jesus continues, yes, the earthly life of Jesus in one sense, but there is also that amazing spirit of generosity, of inclusive love, of encompassing, reaching out care to others. The sharing food together is an awful lot less threatening than sitting down to talk with someone. It always is easier when it's maybe over a tea or coffee or over a meal. It's a more relaxed way to have conversations that go that can go every bit as deep, minus the fear factor. There's something about having something to do with our hands and our mouths and not always having to look at one another in the eye that makes it easier for us to talk about what's on our heart and minds. Some of the most interesting conversations I've had with my sons are when I'm driving in the car and one's a passenger. We're not in direct eye contact, but there's more opportunity sometimes in those situations for things to be shared. And so it is with a mealtime, things can just be relaxed and things can be shared. On a very mundane level, the very best of barbecues are those to which everyone brings a little something. It means that while the host might carry the brunt of the preparation and provision, there might be additional and important extras that are brought along, and these add to the feasting. On the beach, Jesus is the one who supplies the love, the faith, the trust and the acceptance that his friends feared had disappeared when they had abandoned him. And those friends brought along their fears and their guilt, as well as the courage to dare to trust what they had never dared to hope. And so as the disciples joined Jesus for that breakfast, with the fish that they had caught, and with all their different feelings and turmoil that they had undergone, Jesus accepts them, he welcomes them, he shares food with them, and they are renewed, revived, and re-sent out in the mission that Christ has sent them to. And as Jesus cooked, they tasted for themselves a new acceptance and a new expression of the generous love of God made known through Jesus the Son. Thanks be to God. Amen. The choir are going to sing the anthem, A Clear Benediction, by John Rutter.
Thank you.
Let us now draw near to God with our prayers of intercession. Let us pray. Eternal and generous God, we thank you for the Gospels, for the Scriptures, which remind us of your generosity of love and your desire to share and bless, welcome, accept and bring healing and wholeness to people's lives. Help us, we pray, to live as generously, ready to offer time, energy and all that we have and are for your kingdom's sake. Take the gifts you have bestowed us with, and may they symbolize the giving of ourselves afresh to you this day. Use them and use us to spread and to share your love with all, influencing this world with hope, joy, and peace. Lord Jesus Christ, risen to live forever, thank you for continuing to trust us with your good news. Thank you for continuing to stand by us even when we let you down. And thank you for never faltering in your care for us and your love for us, even when we hurt and betray you. May we in return stand by you, care for you, love you, and above all, may we work with you in feeding your sheep. Give us, we pray, the courage as individuals and communities of your people, the courage to listen for your voice, the courage to pick up the nets of old habits, to follow you to different waters. And when we fear where that might lead us, when we hesitate, pulled by the safe and familiar, reassure us of being held in your arms and embolden us simply to follow you. Ever with us, Lord, we bring to you a world you care for deeply, into those places where violence is rife. Bring your peace, we pray. Into those places where hatred and suspicion grow, encourage understanding, we pray. And sow and nurture the seeds of love and respect, where poverty and disease make life miserable for people. Don't let us turn away. Instead, help us to be your hands, your heart, your feet, your voice. For the planet itself, we pray, giving you heartfelt thanks, Lord God, for its beauty, its life and power and majesty. A thing so great and yet so vulnerable. We rejoice in seas, mountains, lakes, fields, beaches and gardens, all of them gifts from you to be enjoyed and cared for. Help us to make sure we do just that. May we thank you, the Creator, for all creation, and know and value our own part in it. We take a moment in silence to pray for the nations, to pray for people we know and are concerned about this morning. We bring these prayers and the assurance you respond to them in your love and wisdom. Loving God, we thank you that you hear these prayers and we can trust them to you. We give thanks for those who have a sense of calling into ministry of word and sacrament. We give thanks for Jamie, who has been with us as our organist and choir leader over these past 3 years. and as he seeks to follow the steps of being led in ministry of word and sacrament. We pray for the congregation where he will be serving as a locum, and for Jamie too, and in that special relationship, that it may be one of blessing, of learning, of discovering, of being led in the calling of Christ for all who gather. We thank you, Lord, for the mystery of worship and the different ways in which you speak and minister to us. Quite different individuals in quite different situations, and yet you minister to us. And so we pray your blessing upon your church in every nation across the world and in every different denomination and style, that it may bring honour and glory to the name of Christ and to his kingdom. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now we're very pleased that Mr. Jamie Campbell is here with us today, and we would like to say one or two words to you, Jamie. He's wearing a mask so we can't see what he's thinking. No, he's not. Jamie has been leading the choir and accompanying us in the music here in the worship. And I'm going to ask first if one of the members of the choir, because the choir and the organist really have a special relationship, if Yvonne would like to share a few words with us.
Thank you. And this brief words on behalf of the choir, Jamie. I wish you were over there somewhere, actually, in the corner.
Could you, Jamie, because Yvonne wanted to speak to the microphone.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Just to put you on the spot, why not? When Ewan left, I did wonder, would we actually get another organist and someone who's able to take the choir? What would this person be like? And actually, I think we've been extremely fortunate in having such a gifted individual as we have with Jamie. We have heard the most amazing organ preludes and various things from Sunday to Sunday. He has taken the choir through centuries of anthems. I think they said we've gone through the last five centuries? We've gone through certainly a lot of different kinds of music, so he's extended our repertoire. And very early on, I thought this was a very serious individual. You know, we had a large choir together for Stainer's Crucifixion, which unfortunately I couldn't manage to attend, but I thought it was a very, very serious individual. And we listened to him. I didn't mean to laugh there, but when you listen to him, you see his sense of humour that comes through. And Thursday evenings are just such an entertainment. He's taken us through his own musical knowledge, which stems from things like Hinjin Bracket, Gilbert and Sullivan, ABBA, as well as the more serious pieces of work as well. And he's one of these people that plays a tune and goes, oh, what does that remind me of? And his brain goes off and picks up about three different tunes in which that will regale us on a Thursday evening, as well as his anecdotes. So Thursday evenings are just not at all going to be the same. He has such confidence in the choir as well, which I really admire. So he pushes us to do what we can as best as we can as well. So thank you, Jamie, for all of that, for all of your knowledge, skill, confidence, humour and fun that you've brought with us. And it's been, we've been blessed by having you here. And I'm very grateful that we've had the time with you that we have. And thank you very much for all that you've done for the choir.
Jamie, a few months ago you gave us your letter of resignation, which was, as one would expect from you, very articulate, gracious and well expressed. And the session clerks, Martin and Sheila, expressed also, along with me, how we valued you greatly, the contribution you have made to the life, ministry and worship here at Holburn West Church. As Yvonne has indicated, you have led the choir well in a repertoire with a wide variety of compositions and styles. You have faced challenges along the way, sometimes with different views expressed. However, you have not let that dishearten or discourage you. You have assisted greatly in a range of activities at the church, such as offering technical advice and assistance, and providing helpful advice and hospitality to music groups using the building. So we'll miss you in many different ways and many different levels here at the church. You clearly have a strong sense of calling to the ministry of word and sacrament. Occasionally, both at Jubilee and morning worship, we have enjoyed the experience of your leading worship in your preaching and prayers. We will miss the joy of your musical contributions to worship here, but I am delighted that you will be having valuable experience as a locum in your further preparation for ministry, which you clearly have a strong sense of calling to. As Jamie knows, I do have one or two gripes about him, and I'm going to mention those. I know I shouldn't interfere, well, do, but I'm going to. As people will know, Jamie has a clear appreciation of clerical attire and smart clothes, and because of that, the minister here at Holburn West has looked rather shabby, shabbily dressed, in contrast to our organist and choir leader. Jamie, you have excelled at being at the church very promptly and in good time for the different events and occasions that you have been involved with. And again, because I'm working alongside you, my title is most definitely confirmed as the late Reverend Duncan Eddy. Anyway, Jamie, we have very much enjoyed your time with us, and as well as your considerable gifts and skills, we have very much enjoyed your sense of fun and humour, eclectic knowledge that you have shared with us, and it's been very sharp and quick, and we're sure that you're going to be blessed through your ministry, and we do very much want to support you with our love and prayers, and of course you'll always be very welcome to be here at Holburn West at any time. And so we'd like to present a gift to you in thanks, and I think it's tremendous. The congregation clearly have enjoyed your ministry to us, particularly through music, and a cheque will be presented to you of over £500 in thanks to you for your time with us here. And we also have a gift that we would like to present to you. It has photos of the church, the stained glass window, the wall hanging, and the exterior of the church, and we have a card. So Jamie, thank you very much for all your ministry. I'm not sure if we can shake hands yet or not, but God bless you and thank you very much.
It's always worrying when someone going into the ministry or in the ministry is asked, would you say a few words? Now, I am conscious that it's, we're after time. It's definitely tea time, so I promise I won't say much. But to start off, when I saw Ewan's post advertised, I thought, do I really want to go there? And I felt a kick that said, yes, you do. So I arrived, I sat roughly where Eileen's sitting, two rows from back, with nobody in front of me. And the choir filed in, this was after my interview, and Verna nudged somebody, and they all went, that's the organist. And I thought, oh heck, anonymity's blown. And then the choir sang without the central orb, and I thought, oh heck, what have I got myself into now? And it's been a learning experience for us all, as we slowly worked around each other, and then together. But honestly, choir, I cannot thank you enough. I know one of them's over there, and one of them's, Verna can't be here, she's at the Scottish Community Drama Finals in Orkney. Competitions come first, although I don't think she's competing this time. I digress. Choir, thank you. I don't think there's been any piece that I've thrown in front of you that you've thrown back at me, except from my very favourite anthem of all times, which you tried for a month and then said, we're not doing it, James. But never mind, but thank you for your dedication, for your hard work, for everything that you have put up with, including me occasionally breaking into the theme from Coronation Street, or anything that comes to mind while rehearsing an anthem. And to you lot, thank you as well for putting up with me. I know I'm slightly eccentric, but then again, who's normal? I'm going to miss you. I really am. But that kick that got me here has also decided to kick me again. We knew this day was coming at some point, but it seems to have come slightly earlier and also slightly later than we all expected. So thank you for the opportunity to serve you as your organist. And well, I won't be too much of a stranger, because it seems to be that I've been roped into the Jubilee preaching rota. And once you're on that thing, you don't get off. So I shall hopefully see you again soon, and every blessing.
So, just remind folk, you're very welcome for tea and coffee too in the large hall at the close of the service. So we sing our closing hymn today, which is 336, Christ is our light, the bright and morning star. Transforming love of God.
God does not make things as they are. With God, all things are made new.
All creation responds to God's presence. The world is alive with possibility.
We open
ourselves to this truth. With Christ, we trust our whole lives to this power. Nothing is beyond the reach of God, neither evil, nor hardship, nor death. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit descend upon you, dwell within you, this day and evermore. Amen.